Being bandmates with your siblings sounds like it could be the best thing in the world, but in reality, it could be an absolute nightmare. While their chemistry outwardly looked pleasant during their time in the Jackson 5, these performing brothers soon developed a sibling rivalry that became especially fierce years after the group's Motown heyday. That rivalry being between Michael Jackson and his older brother Jermaine. Family Affair. When the Jacksons were first floating the idea of a reunion tour, with Jermaine rejoining the group after 8 years of being a solo artist, the family believed the focus should be on the brothers as a collective, a homecoming after 20 years of performing together. However, after the recent skyrocketing fame and incredible commercial success of Michael's solo work, when asked, many promoters narrowed in on the moonwalking performer as the true star and his brothers as a pleasant addition, but their involvement was not critical to the tour's potential success. Having not toured since leaving his brothers in 1975, Jermaine and the rest of the family weren't too pleased with the prospect of being relegated to mere accessories to Michael the superstar. Quote, "Promoters were only interested in how much money they could get off the top, and in putting Michael over here, me over there, splitting everyone up. We weren't interested in that," Jermaine stated, believing that they all came up together, had their own parts to play in their success, and should be valued as a unit in all its parts, despite Michael's recent popularity as a solo artist eclipsing that of the band's. Quote, "A lot of people weren't taking into consideration that this is a family, not ignoring the fact that Michael has had the biggest album ever, but still, we want to make sure everyone is totally involved." It was a change of tune for Jermaine, a guy who went out of his way to be his own man, carving a life outside the tight-knit Jackson family, then quickly making it clear that his allegiance to and protectiveness of that family is just as important to him now as ever. Flamboyant, controversial promoter Don King, quote, "came aboard speaking about family unity, family love, and wanted my mother and father involved," said Jermaine. Quote, "We are very much a democracy." Although a pleasant thought to have one of pop music's most hotly anticipated tours rooted in family behind the scenes, the reality of its execution wasn't as idealistic as it sounds, as demonstrated in the production of the tour's accompanying record. Death by Committee. In the months leading up to the tour's opening night, a large focus of the Jacksons' reunion was for them to all get back into the studio. However, unlike previously when they would collaborate, playing off each other's strengths and ideas, which often led to Michael being up front, this time each member of the band would have the opportunity to showcase their individual talents. Knowing that it would be difficult to get all the brothers together at the same time in the studio and agree on the record's direction, lyric writing and production responsibilities were equally divided between brothers, like dessert at a family picnic. Each took ownership of their dedicated tracks and employed available band members to sing lead and backup when needed. However, quote, "getting approval from everyone about everything" was the excuse Jermaine gave for the record's many delays. Even though he barely featured, only contributing lead vocals on one track, Torture, which also featured Michael and Jackie. Torture was the only one of two singles to have an accompanying video in which neither Jermaine nor Michael appeared in, with the brothers resorting to a wax dummy of Michael from Madame Tussauds to act as a stand-in. Although he agreed to join the Jacksons in the studio, Jermaine was more focused on his solo record and notes that he cut it much quicker because, quote, "I was my own boss." While his brothers were busy recording Victory, Jermaine paid two promotional visits to Europe, doing as many major media interviews as his record label could line up for him. As one Arista spokeswoman put it, quote, "the schedule this guy is on is beyond my comprehension. There's a part of him that's a businessman, though." During their recording sessions, reports circulated that tensions were building between the brothers and as a result, minimal publicity photography was done. Instead of a photo session, they commissioned the cover artwork from famed illustrator Michael Whelan. Portraying the brothers united in a strong stance, Michael at the back of the pack behind his five less famous brothers. This depiction may be demonstrating the brothers' fear of being overshadowed or Michael's lack of enthusiasm for the project and the band at that point. After numerous delays, the album was in stores just in time for the Victory Tour's promised kickoff. CBS planned a $500,000 marketing promotional push for the release and predicted sales of 5 million units, according to Billboard magazine. However, reviews were mixed at best, critics calling the group's musical output unclear and half-baked. One critic asserting, quote, "the enormous shadow cast by Michael's LPs weigh heavily on their first studio album in 4 years. It is a weight that would make any record a losing proposition. Still, the brothers could have done better than this." After many months of damning headlines concerning the disorganization and crooked tactics of those managing the now grotesquely overhyped tour, resentment built, and public support had turned on Michael and his brothers. Although rumors of infighting persisted, Jermaine was keen to put up a united front with the inner sleeve of his new solo album, saying, quote, "My brothers Jackie, Tito, Michael, Marlon, and Randy, I love you. It's been 8 years or more since we've done anything. Let's go out there and give the people what they want. I love you all. Jermaine." Tour of the Century. As time went on, the Victory Tour became increasingly ambitious and its bloated production costs harder to manage. Although Jermaine and much of his family believed it necessary due to the stature of the talents involved. Quote, "There's myself, Michael, the Jackson 5, and the Jacksons. Each act has their own set of attorneys and accountants. When we traveled as the Jackson 5, we had a road crew of 8. Now, it's over 100 people for this tour. It's become a circus that can easily get out of control." That being said, it was unsurprising that although the brothers all had their own teams, Michael was the one generating an overwhelming level of interest for the tour, appearing on the cover of over 200 magazines in the first half of 1984. Now dubbed by overzealous promoters as the Tour of the Century, immense pressure was placed on Michael's shoulders to live up to the iconic status his image, moves, and videos had molded for him. Was Michael Jackson the greatest talent the world of entertainment had ever seen? Or was he a manufactured, masterfully produced, and overhyped pop puppet that would disappoint his legion of fans once he finally hit center stage? Despite the tour's name, the Jacksons didn't perform any of the album's material in their appearances. They said that they wanted to wait until the songs were better known to their fans, but as only one track was garnered a hit, Michael's collaboration with Mick Jagger's State of Shock, that never happened. Perpetual mismanagement and internal bickering plagued the brothers as they progressed with the tour, and the cracks were starting to show. With numerous publications reporting that Michael repeatedly threatened to quit the shows altogether. In response to the speculation, Jermaine responded, quote, "It's something you really can't control. Both positive or negative, we're on the people's lips, and the time to worry is when they stop talking about you." While Michael behind the scenes found the tour, excuse the pun, torture, Jermaine used the platform to his advantage and took every opportunity to promote himself and his new music. With the band's Shire superstar lead vocalist refusing all interviews, Jermaine would often fill in as the group's number two, generating countless headlines and column inches for the fledging artist as the Victory Tour approached each city on its route. Jermaine even flew out to make a guest appearance on the popular soap opera As the World Turns, where he played himself in an episode and sung two tracks from his latest album. After he would go back on the road with his brothers, where he had the opportunity to perform solo to seas of tens of thousands night after night. One track he performed that was gaining popularity in dance clubs was the duet he did with his brother Michael, "Tell Me I'm Not Dreaming, Too Good to Be True." Receiving heavy airplay, both Jermaine and his label, Arista, were keen to release it as his next single. However, Michael's label, CBS, barred Arista from doing so, which clearly crushed Jermaine. Quote, "This would probably be my only number one ever, but I can't put it out," Jermaine said of the song. Quote, "Michael okayed it 3 times, but he says there is nothing he can do." Industry insiders speculated that after the gigantic success of Thriller and Michael being heavily featured in the recent hit, Rockwell's Somebody's Watching Me, the label wanted to prevent overexposing his already pervasive voice on radio airwaves, especially with the Victory album having just been released. But for an artist as powerful as Michael Jackson, could he have overridden his label and allowed the track to be released? Or was it a convenient excuse to squash any further association Michael had with his feuding brothers? As the Victory Tour progressed, tensions built, and press outlets stoked rumors of a deep-seated jealousy between the brothers. Quote, "There's no rivalry," Jermaine confirmed. Quote, "It's like his success is our success, and our success is his. I can put any of my songs up against the songs of Michael. It's just that his songs are timely." In later interviews, Jermaine goes on to remind audiences that without himself, his brothers, and Motown, there would be no Michael Jackson of today, diminishing Michael's contribution to his skyrocketing career as a solo artist. Quote, "I'm not here to talk about Motown, but you gotta give credit where it's due. They laid the foundation so strong. It made the Jackson 5 pyramid so strong. They laid the foundation for Michael's success." A statement like this would have likely infuriated Michael, who experienced many of those around him attempting to take credit away from him for his recent record-breaking moves. He was determined more than ever to prove himself, to stand on his own and be lauded as one of the greatest artists the world has ever seen, without the noise from producers, record labels, business managers, or even his family trying to take credit for his accomplishments. Aftershock. Once the Victory Tour's initial U.S. dates had passed, many behind the scenes hoped that the brothers would continue by bringing their tour to Europe. However, on the last night of a six-night sellout at Los Angeles' Dodger Stadium, Michael made a surprise statement on stage calling an end to the tour and confirming his departure from the Jacksons. The public admission was shocking to his brothers, but it didn't surprise them. Jermaine floated the idea of continuing the tour, but without his brothers, the concept failed to generate much of a buzz and was soon abandoned. Instead, Jermaine would focus on his solo work, hoping to take the excitement that the Victory Tour generated and transfer it into his own music career. With a $750,000 video attached, he released When the Rain Begins to Fall with Pia Zadora. The single became a major hit for him in Europe, reaching the number one spot in Belgium, France, Germany, the Netherlands, and Switzerland. He also achieved the biggest hit from his self-titled album, Do What You Do, which reached the top 10 charts in Europe and a respectable number 13 on the Billboard Hot 100. The music video was directed by the MTV-friendly Bob Giraldi, who had previously worked on Michael Jackson's Beat It, Say Say Say, and the Jacksons' Pepsi commercials, and featured supermodel Iman, who played Jermaine's love interest. Outside his music career, Jermaine Jackson was living the life of a chart-topping pop star. Flying on private jets, he discussed in exhaustive detail his efforts to buy an entire island in Fiji. He lived in an 8,700-square-foot, 4-bedroom, 5-bath mansion in Brentwood, Los Angeles. Jermaine added his own style to the property by commissioning personalized replicas of the Tsarist-era St. Petersburg gates for its entrance. Called an, quote, ostentatiously grotesque display of wealth and distasteful by neighbors, the 16-foot arched iron gates caused such an uproar Jermaine had to appeal the city's decision that enforced the removal of his $250,000 addition. A reality check. After the heady heights of the Victory Tour and having his music achieve some chart success, Jermaine was keen to embark on his first solo tour with the release of his 1986 album, Precious Moments. However, without Michael and the press interest in a superstar tour, the album and its singles failed to generate much of a buzz. In contrast to just 2 years earlier, Jermaine Jackson was now performing an elaborately staged and lit 75-minute set to modest crowds of a few hundred in half-filled auditoriums. 10 musicians joined him on stage, including 3 female backup singers, 4 keyboard players, a guitarist, drummer, and percussionist. In the backstage corridors, there were a couple dozen men all seemingly involved with the tour, half of them appearing to be security waiting for something to happen. Quote, "It's too much. It's overkill," said one bystander. Quote, "There is in fact no security threat, no screaming hordes, just a handful of preteen autograph seekers waiting quietly." Gone were the days of packed-out stadiums, daily press coverage, controversy, hype, and millions in revenue, even though some vestiges of that period remained. Quote, "A lot of people ask me, how are you going to play these places? But this is my first solo tour ever. I'm not going on the fact that I was on the Victory Tour, and we played all those huge stadiums and stuff. Sometimes you must take a step sideways before you take a step forward." However, critics considered that on his first solo tour, Jermaine made a tactical error by performing a medley of Jackson 5 hits that Michael had originally sang lead on, including I'll Be There, I Want You Back, ABC, and Never Can Say Goodbye, inviting comparisons between him and his superstar brother. One commentator writing, quote, "Jermaine just doesn't compare to Michael. Wait a minute, though. Who can compare to Michael Jackson? The point is that Jermaine invites the comparison, and it isn't necessary." However, Jermaine didn't see the Michael connection as an issue, at least at this time, that it only enhanced his own appeal for audiences. Quote, "You can see all of us in one of us. We all have that Jackson mystique," Jermaine proclaimed. While on tour, Jermaine also changed his tune when it came to performing with his brothers again. As after the Victory Tour ended in 1984, both Jermaine and Michael denied that the group would ever perform together again. However, Jermaine would go on to tease audiences with the possibility that it may happen after all. Quote, "At the time, we said some things we didn't mean. Right now, Michael's doing another record and I'm moving on to bigger things. We may tour again, but first, we want to create some more excitement." Aside from his music career, his private life had taken a downturn as well. In 1987, Hazel, his wife of 14 years and daughter of the owner of his former record label, filed a petition for divorce. Hazel stating that the couple separated last August because of irreconcilable differences. She said that she was humiliated by the singer after he paraded his mistress's love child at a star-studded party with his then-pregnant wife by his side. Even before this incident, Hazel also endured embarrassment when in 1986, Jermaine took another 22-year-old mistress, Margaret Maldonado, on tour with him, and later revealed he had a long-standing affair with a then-unknown Whitney Houston while working together. As a result of the divorce proceedings, Jermaine's soon-to-be ex-wife sought spousal support and joint custody of the couple's three children. As a result of an expensive divorce and with child support payments needing to be met, he needed a break more than ever. But by 1988, Jermaine's career had hit a brick wall, and he was taking any gig he could get. One show critic commenting, quote, "So here he is, 18 years after the Jackson 5 first raced to the top of the US charts, playing the Australian nightclub scene with a pickup band of Aussie session musicians. Now he graces the stage in front of a tiny dance floor and entertains an audience largely made up of Japanese tourists, bored eastern suburbs, lounge lizards, and balding middle-aged businessmen." It appears that for Jermaine at least, a Jackson's reunion of sorts might be welcomed sooner than he had originally thought. If you enjoyed this, then check out other Jackson family dynamics we've documented in previous videos. Links are in the description box below. Subscribe for part 4 as we next explore Jermaine's many attempts to orchestrate a Jackson's reunion, one that crucially included Michael, as well as what led to a vicious and public falling out with his superstar younger brother.